Yes.
వెయిట్ చేస్తున్నారమ్మా మనసి
Sorry, ma'am.
Yeah.
It is live on YouTube and we are good to go, so I am going on mute.
You're going on mute, is it?
Yeah, I mean, I'll not, my voice won't be heard from now. If anything, okay. You can always ping me on WhatsApp. I'll be there.
Okay. Done. Okay.
Have a good webinar.
Thank you so much, beta. Thank you for all the help. हरिदासन सर नमस्ते.
कलर जोड़ते
Sir, we can see your email page. Can you change it back to the presentation? Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good evening, Yadav sir.
Yes, good evening, sir. Good evening.
I am Haridasan.
Haridasan sir, I heard your name. So nice to meet on this.
Yes, I am.
Occasion.
Yes, sir. I am also. That's why eagerly waiting. Nurunnisa has arranged this one. And thank you so
namaste,
much.
Namaste, sir.
Namaste, Nuri. Namaste.
कैसे हैं सर आप?
ठीक है bro. ठीक है, हमको यादव साहब को एक बार हम लोग का स्टेट में लेके आना है पालकाड़ में.
आएंगे दोस्तों, क्यों?
जी 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 जी
पालकाड़.
और आपका सर कैसे है कोल्हापुर? हम आया थे ना उधर
कोल्हापुर सर. फ्लड सिचुएशन नाउ इट इज ओके. आई मीन ऑलरेडी इट हैज डन लॉट ऑफ हार्म.
अवर गार्डन आल्सो?
नो, गार्डन इज ऑन हिल टॉप.
ओके ओके.
And then COVID conditions are again not good. Good, we are not in good state.
Oh,
I don't know, but
but in that,
myself, my family, my research scholars,
uh-huh.
all of them, none of them got infected in last 1.5 years.
Very good.
And I should share with you that you know.
Sir.
My doctor, who is MD, heart specialist.
Yes.
He MD, he's an allopathy doctor. He told us, sir, you take Mahasudarshan Kada.
Uh-huh.
And since he told, because I believe him just like a God's order. All of us we started taking.
Yes, sir.
Every day after dinner, we take one spoon, one cup of water.
Okay.
And none of us, we got infected. And then I was just analyzing what is this Mahasudarshan Kadha.
Uh-huh.
I analyzed all the plants in that.
Uh-huh.
There are out of 54, 52 are plants.
Oh, God.
And out of 52 plants, 30 plants are antiviral and immunity boosters.
Oh, very good. Very
already
good.
Established. Uh-huh. That means they don't allow that virus to infect you only.
Oh, yes.
This is what I have come to conclusion, but you know, our Ayurveda or our original systems, and then I remembered my mother used to give decoction of some very bitter plants when I used to get temperature, that is antiviral.
Yes. Even we take here, sir, like that only, all this Tenospora, then andrographis. And
right, andrographis is the main component in that, sir.
Okay.
What
you said, madam?
Can we start by 5-5, sir?
No problem. For me, there is no problem. Only okay. I may need some 5-10 minutes more.
Oh, please, sir. Please, sir.
It's always a pleasure, sir. It is good that you should take more time. So, looking forward to your presentation, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. When you are there, of course, whatever I feel or whatever I have studied, I will express.
Yes.
But
all, sir.
In front of Haridasan, little bit it makes me nervous, you know.
No,
you have done so much work in Himalaya. And,
not, sir. आपका जो personal experience है, how you have gone to the ground realities and you are presenting that so good, sir. I saw your that Kolhapur garden, no, the lead garden. How nice, sir. So we look forward to some collaboration from there also. Future, I will contact you, sir.
Definitely, sir. We have to collaborate. We have to exchange our germplasm.
Yes.
And yesterday that NBRI meeting was there.
Uh-huh.
And I told them that CSR doesn't mean that it is only government they can do. You should collaborate with universities, other organizations, research organizations. You cannot do everything. This is what I told the director.
Excellent.
You know, because they have closed the system.
Yes.
You know, how government can be closed to country, to any researcher or any research scholar in the country or any institute.
So
they have their own agenda and they are taking projects of big money, you know, crores of rupees.
They are in crores only.
Sitting in those air conditioner room and doing work. This is, you know, I don't know. At ground level, how many of them are working? So, this is the thing, sir.
Main aapne achha kiya, sir. You brought this point.
I told very strongly. The entire RSC committee, I told.
Okay.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I am Dr. Ali Bolali, retired associate professor.
Ali.
But also the author of Flora of Andhra Pradesh along with Pullaya, sir.
Pullaya, sir, Okay. Today I am going to show Shiropija Pullayi.
Shiropija Pullayi, new from Nigiri Forest, Anantapur district.
No, I have grown it in my garden. I used to grow it.
Oh, it looks like
Mahabali. Mahabali.
It has been collected from Nigiri Forest from Anantapur. Just 100 kilometers away from Anantapur. Very good. And that forest is mostly endemic to so many species. Recently also one grass was recognized.
People are working nicely, students are working. We have to encourage them and they are doing really good work.
And also that forest is having Hildegardia populifolia, endemic plant.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Can we start now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. the University of Transdisciplinary Health Sciences and Technology, Bengaluru, welcomes one and all for today's talk by a beloved and very well-known taxonomist, Professor S.R. Yadav. We thank from the bottom of our heart for the profuse response for our webinar. To have smooth talk, we request the participants to kindly mute your mic. Kindly put your questions in the chat box. Now, a brief on Professor S.R. Yadav. As a plant taxonomist, Sir has dedicated his life in exploring Western Ghats, worked on biosystematics and conservation of rare plants. His conservation effort is visible at the Lead Botanical Garden, Shivaji University, Kolhapur. Along with this, Sir has been a dedicated plant photographer, and he has collection of more than 2,000 plant species photographed, especially of Western Ghats and rare species of Maharashtra. Sir has won several awards, and few of them are late Professor B.B. Shivarajan Gold Medal for outstanding contribution in plant systematics in Indian Association of Taxonomy of Angiosperms. Sir has guided 11 MPhil, more than 30 PhD students. Sir has, to his credit, 6 floras and more than 300 scientific papers and several popular articles. Sir is a member of more than 20 professional bodies and societies, such as life member of Indian Association of Angiosperm Taxonomy, member of Society of Aroids, USA. Dear participants, the PDF of Sir's lecture will be emailed to you all. With this brief, not taking much of the time, I hand over the stage to Sir. Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much for introduction, and it is always good to listen good about you. That is a human nature. I am thankful to University of Trans and the organizers, especially Dr. Ravi Kumar, Nuri, Manasvi, Sabi Mundur, and our Dr. Haridasan, who is an inspiration for me, one kind of inspiration, because although we have met very few times, but he's a person who is down to earth. With this, today I have been asked to talk on rare plants of Western Ghats, their potentials and utilization in sustainable development. Really speaking, for me, every plant is a resource. Every plant, it is rare or common plant, every plant is a resource of human beings. It is a biological capital of man, and that is the only true capital human beings need, really. You know, I have plants in our life. You see, every pleasure of our life, every luxury of our life, peace of mind, all that, you know, which we need, comes, that is, from plants and nature. All other things like car, TVs, tape recorders, cameras, these are secondary. Primary is my health, my hunger, my oxygen, or my breath. Only after these, all these things start, and all these things are come to us from plants. So first of all, I will say that every plant is a resource, and its utilization in sustainable way is a responsibility of entire human beings, all human beings. You know, all over the world, we are cutting tropical forest at the rate of 300 acres per hour. 300 acres per hour. Per minute, we are losing at least one flowering plant species. And that way, we are really, our bioresources, day by day, they are diminishing in nature. In this background, it is very necessary to educate society, our policymakers, our ministers, that what is very important, development is one part, but when development, at what cost, and really what we need. And therefore, teacher like me, teacher like Haridasan and many teachers give a lecture on sustainable development. And sustainable development has a very big meaning. It starts from you and me, that whatever resources we have, we should use them judiciously, and that is a real. Talking is a different and actually doing is a different. And you know, marriage parties and many parties, how much we waste our resources. That with that brief introduction, I will go to Western Ghats. India is one of the, of course, many times you must have heard this sentence, 17 mega diverse countries of the world. We have three hotspots. We have hottest hotspot, that is the Western Ghats. This is the Western Ghat, you can see. Of course, in Maharashtra, we don't have many trees, but as you go to south, we have wonderful vegetation. And this, I am fortunate that I born in India, and especially on the shoulders of Western Ghats. Now this Western Ghat, little bit information on Western Ghat, it is a biogeographical, very important biogeographical province of India, playing important role in peninsular India. You know, hydrological cycle. Now Kolhapur was flooded, okay, totally last 1 week before, and everything was stopped. So bringing rains and making rain is a function of Western Ghats. And you know, hydrological cycle is controlled by Western Ghats and all perennial rivers, which, you know, irrigate land of peninsular India, originate in Western Ghats. So their role in agriculture, role in, I mean, development, progress, it has a great role. Similarly, it plays very important role in climatology. We enjoy a very nice climate all along the Western Ghat because of Western Ghats. And third, biodiversity. You know, it is a mega diversity area. Known flora is about 12,000 species, total 12,000 species. It occupies just 5% of India's total area, just 5%. But how? It has 26 to 27% of total biodiversity of India. So it's an importance to us, Western Ghats. So it is a treasure of biodiversity. High endemism. There are about 5,588 indigenous flowering plant species, of which 2,253 are endemic to India. They are also found in Western Ghats. And about 1,200 species are exclusively endemic to Western Ghats. And here, you know, almost in a one year, we describe, in 1 decade, we describe about 25 to 30 species. So new species have been added. Just this is for information that we should be aware of what is importance. Madhav Gadgil gave report on Western Ghat and made efforts to make maximum eco-sensitive area, but this proposal was not accepted by our policymakers, our government, and they don't understand importance. So every citizen of our country should know why Western Ghats are so important for all of us, why they are so dear to us. Now, this is the figures I will not go, but total flowering plant, this is a data taken from NIAR TS. Okay, 7,402 indigenous species, 5,588, endemic 2,253, and Western Ghat 1,273 species. These are endemic. Okay, so with this, now you know, when I think about plants, the true matrix of human life is the green world that covers the earth. True matrix of our life comes from these green works. The fascinating physical, emotional, and spiritual relationship with nature that I need not to explain. Hello? Hello? Somebody
yes,
should answer.
We can hear you, sir.
Okay. So, fascinating emotional and spiritual relationship with our nature. Whenever we get holiday, we go to forest. Today, Ravi Kumar is also in forest, deep forest. Okay, he is enjoying. Anyway, see this Kas Plateau, Western Ghats, beautiful, you know. Just I am showing you diversity of Western Ghats. And I told, every plant species is our bioresource. And we have to use it in a sustainable way. See this, some small herbaceous plants like Iriocolans, Utricularias, Impatiens, Murdanias, Comelinas, and so on. Such a beautiful diversity we have. I am showing you why plants, you know, it is really, it is an amazing diversity which we have in plants. Every plant species has produced a different type of flower. It is a different in shape, size, color, and structure and architecture. So that way, we have a great diversity of plants with us. You can see this. Just I am showing some plants from our Western Ghats, right? Just legumes I have showed. Then see this, some Cisalpinaceae members, except this one and two, all are from our country. Then you see this compositae, which we have in our Western Ghats. Many of them are endemic. Some are restricted to in distribution. And you see this Malvaceae, beautiful Malvaceae, which we have many members. Many of them are endemic, right? Then you see this Syzygium, Eugenia, family Myrtaceae. It has equally very good diversity and many species, three species are endemic to especially Kerala region. Then we have this Asclepias, you know, wonderful diversity. You tell me why I have taken these photographs. I cannot, if I go on describing one flower for 1 hour, you will not understand anything. But if I show flower in photograph, you can really appreciate the nature's creation. So these are our Asclepias. See this Comelinas, wonderful diversity. And you know, see this Murdania striati petala, the color and all that, you know, it is amazing for me and for everyone. Acanthaceae of our country. Then you see Utricularia, bladderworts of our country. We have more than about 40 species of bladderworts, Utricularias. A wonderful diversity of Utricularias with wonderful, beautiful blue, pink, and yellow flowers we have in Utricularias. Okay, that is also a bioresource. Okay, now you see, I showed you diversity of plants, little diversity, not much. And then I come to the rare endangered plant species and their economic potentials. Now you see, this is a group known as Myristicaceae. These Myristicaceae are, you know, it is a basal family. Basal angiosperms, we call them basal angiosperms. Myristicaceae is very old family, and we have many members of Myristicaceae in Western Ghats. Now see this, how you can see this seed. Seed is with aril. Okay, this aril is used in medicines and also it is in spices. So this group, I will introduce some plants from Western Ghats, and it is one of the very important bioresource which we have to use sustainably. Now you see, this is a this one, our Myris, this is the wrongly place. This is the our Myristica dactyloides. You can see this Myristica dactyloides, which is common in Western Ghats, right? And you see this plant, whatever information I have got from other sources that I am sharing with, seeds are applied in two indolent and ill-conditioned ulcers. It allays pains, cleans the surface, and establish healthy action. Seeds are given in diabetes. Bark decoction is given in AIDS and so on. So this is a source. And this source, we should use sustainably. I will tell you what is happening. Now, this is our Jaipal. Of course, it is a cultivated plant. But why I'm showing, all of you know, this Myristica fragrance and its importance in our life. From Java, we have introduced it in India, and it is very important a crop plant, I mean, a tree crop in India. Now, this is Myristica mulbarica. Now, what I want to bring to your notice, this, when I had gone to Yellapur, in Yellapur region, you know, local people extract these fruits before they mature. Okay, before they mature, reason is because there is a competition to collect this aril. And immature fruits are collected and immature seeds they throw, and none of them germinate. So every year, if we go on collecting these fruits when they are immature, there will not be seeding, there will not be new plants, and only older plants will be surviving. So how to use them sustainably? And then we have to educate local people that when they collect fruits, they should be matured. And after maturation, all these seeds have to be re-sown in a Western Ghat, so that we can use, we can, I mean, restore the species, and we can also utilize. So this is one example I'm telling from Myristica mulbarica, which is Kaipa or Ranpa. In Marathi, we call Kaipa. Now you see this, there are various, I mean, unfortunately, I should have concentrated on only one aspect, but I am supposed to talk on, you know, utilization of plants for ornamental purpose, for medicinal purpose, for agriculture, for fruits, and for as a crop, wild relatives of crop plants. And therefore, whole thing is getting mixed up. So this is Aricima. You see this all Aricimas, right? And these Aricimas, now you see this Aricima, it stands in nature like this with this white spade, pink throat, for 1 month, and this can be very good ornamentals. And in other countries, they have societies of orides. In India, we don't have any society of orides. Professor Sivadasan was doing some, he did very good work, his student did, but we don't have society to work upon orides and their utilization, sustainable utilization for various purposes, maybe starch, maybe ornamental value, maybe as a vegetable, because they are used as vegetables, they are starch resources, and they are ornamental value also. So this is another group which we can think and some student can do. Now this is another group known as Amorphopalus. Amorphopalus, Peony folius, Suran, all of us we know. Suran, we eat. And see, these all are Amorphopalus species, you know, Amorphopalus bulbipar, Amorphopalus commutatus, Amorphopalus hoencari, conchonensis, then longiconnectivitis, Peony folius, margaritifer, and then this is Mysuriensis, this is a Smithsonianus, and this is a Sylviaticus, this is Bhandarensis. So these species, they have corms, underground corms, and in the age of climate change, the underground corms are the plants which store food underground will be of more significance for human beings. From that angle, it is important. It's a, you can see the architecture of spadics. There's, you know, arrangement of male, female, and neuter flowers. All that is amazing to me. And this, the many of them, you know, many of the Amorphopalus species are known only from type localities. And that way, how to conserve them, how to utilize them is an important thing. Now, another group, Aponogetanaceae, I will be talking about Aponogetanaceae. Of course, it is not a big source, but it is a very good aquatic plant, ornamental plant, number one. Number two, Aponogeton appendiculatus, which grows in Kerala and in Tamil Nadu, some Vembanad lakes in rice fields. And the tubers are boiled and eaten. Okay. tubers are boiled and eaten. These tubers are boiled and eaten. Every Aponogeton species has a tuber. Today, all wetlands, they are getting infested with weeds like Pistia, like Icornia, and in front of them, our Aponogetons cannot stand. They have to leave the place because Icornia, Pistia will be taking place. South India already it has happened. And many places these species have become rare. Of course, these are starchy tubers which are edible, and that is one thing for this group, Aponogeton, Aponogetonaceae. Right? Now, underexplored medicinal plants or commercial plants, this is one group known as Camptothica indica. This is Camptothica indica, Iphigenia magnifica, Iphigenia indica, Iphigenia spilata, and Iphigenia mysuriensis. This is also a very rare plant. What is the importance of this plant? This is a colchicine yielding plant. We extract colchicine from Gloriosa superba, but these are the plants which are which have a very good content of colchicine in seeds, especially Iphigenia spilata. Now, we need to develop agro techniques for their cultivation so that we need not to import colchicine from other countries, or only we cannot depend on this one, Gloriosa. See this, I want to introduce those who are students, all the Iphigenia species I have given here, so that you will not make mistake in identification. In one slide, Camptorrhiza indica, Iphigenia magnifica, then Iphigenia mysuriensis, Iphigenia pallida, Iphigenia stilata, and Iphigenia, one is Sahyadrica. Okay, so these species, these seeds are colchicine yielding plants. Okay, you can see this, all this I have given, because student will be happy to identify all these species. Now they are flowering. Now see, Gloriosa superba, this is a plant. The tuber is used as an anthelmintic, laxative, alexeric, arbificient, used in chronic ulcers, leprosy, inflammation, and so on. So these are the uses, and it is a colchicine yielding plant. Of course, Gloriosa in some places we have started cultivating for their seeds. Okay, so this is now another very important group of our peninsular India is Crinum. Now I will tell you in the end what is the importance of Crinum. First of all, I will introduce the genus Crinum in peninsular India. This is Crinum brachinema, which is a critically endangered species of our country. Even if we want to utilize, we cannot utilize because it is a very rare in occurrence. So multiplication is essential, conservation is essential, and it is one of the beautiful species of our country. Then this is a another species that is Crinum latifolium. You can see this Crinum latifolium. And then you can see this another species, this which we describe. This is Crinum malabaricum. You see, this is a wonderful species described from Periyar region of Kerala. And, you know, really I am lucky that we could locate this species in a stream which has longest leaves in the genus Crinum in the entire world. Okay, so this is species. Now you see, this species grows in India. Another species, little bit closely related, Thayanum, grows in Thailand. Okay, so this is the way it goes. Okay. Now you see, what is the importance of this discovery, this species? This species, this is a very important resource, rare plant. It is restricted. Now you can see, we will read, Crinum malabaricum has the longest leaves, 15 feet in the genus Crinum in the entire world. You know, leaves grow approximately 5 centimeters per day. But third point is very of very importance, crucial importance. It is restricted to 0.5 square kilometers, or at the max 1 square kilometer. It grows in a stream, two streams. It is so far located. So it is a critically endangered species, and it is allied to Thayanum, and it is a tetraploid. And read the last sentence. Chemical analysis, phytochemical analysis was done, and this species has highest galanthamine content in the bulb. Now, it is very rare. At the same time, economically, it is very important. Now it is a challenge for all of us, all the scientists, research scholars, how to, you know, increase the population and really harvest the galanthamine, which is used in Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so this is a one example I give. Then you see this is a Crinum lorifolium, right? Crinum pratens. This is Crinum woodroy, another very interesting species with very large bulbs, which grows in Maharashtra and Karnataka. Now see these bulbs at Mahabaleshwar. Once upon a time, people used to sell these plants, and rich people coming from car, they used to take, because bulbs are about 15 to 20 centimeter in diameter, and that shape, and so it was in. So, phytochemical analysis yielded a vast array of compounds, including more than 150 different alkaloids. In Crinum bulbs, more than 150 different alkaloids have been reported. These are of the amyrlidase type and are analgesic, anticholinergic, anti-tumor, and antiviral. The medicinal properties of Crinum, only an estimated 20% species worldwide are analyzed. So 20% species, we have discovered 150 different alkaloids of medicinal value. Okay. So see this, you know, this is a Crinum, different Crinums. These are the bulbs, and they can grow in the sandy soils along seashores. They grow easily, we can grow. But, you know, we have, if human beings try, we can increase populations. And you see in my garden, almost all the species from peninsular India, we have introduced as a germplasm bank of Crinum species, Crinum latifolium, Crinum woodroy, and so on. See this, you know, now this bioresource, I want to tell you, this Crinum genus as such, as a bioresource, it has great ornamental value for leaves, for flowers. It has bulbs which have many alkaloids used in Alzheimer and many other diseases. And such a bioresource, we should not tap from wild. Can we grow for, this is from seashore. You can see on one side, in sandy soils, it grows so nicely. And this way, this is one very important, and we have to use it and see the, against, see how it looks. Okay. So this is the one source. And I was talking about, you know, this galanthamine generic razadine. Galanthamine is used to treat mild to moderate dementia caused by Alzheimer's disease. Okay. So see, 60 tablets of that compound cost you 3,500. It is one of the costliest drug. Okay. Only rich people can reach to this, and these tablets, and this was, I mean, the outside it is extracted from narcissus, then from licorice and galanthus. But our Crinum is also a great source of this galanthamine. So this way, I want to give you one example of Crinum. Now, another genus is a Pancratia. And, you know, I am a taxonomist. That is what Nuri introduced. I am a botanist, really speaking. I see from various angles any plant. So these are our Pancratium. See, Pancratium vericundum, longiflorum, donaldi, parvum, then our this one is parvum again. Okay, this is a nairi. This one is also nairi. This is a jhelanicum, and this is a triflora. All the species I have shown. Now these have also same compounds. Read here. To date, 53 different alkaloids have been isolated from the pancratium genus, the crinine and hemathamine type alkaloids together with the lycorin type alkaloids are the most abundant alkaloids in this genus. It is important to note that several pancratium species biosynthesize diverse alkaloids in large amounts. So another genus I am giving you, those who are phytochemists, those are working in Ayurveda system, this is one source, and many of the pancratium species are again endemic to India. They are rare plants, and again, we need to care for this germplasm and utilize sustainably for our development. Another group is chlorophytum. Saped musli, you know, saped musli, and all these are the kinds of chlorophytum species. Chlorophytum, we have about 22 species of chlorophytum, and chlorophytum tuberosum, brevis capum, then pterogarpa, this one, colapurens, our brevis capum, this is brevis capum, this is a, here name down, I am not able to, sorry. Then this is chlorophytum baruchi, which is an important source of saped musli, right? So this is a saped musli. And now from wild, lot of plants have been exploited from our Melghat region. Now it has become rare plant and it is important source. The roots are given as a stomachic, tonic, aphrodisiac, galactogous, astringent, and so on. I am not expert in this. I have taken it from books. And this powder, you know, 2,000 rupees per kg powder, we eat. Saped musli. They are already, products are there. Root, 100 gm grams of white musli, chlorophytum borole, and 375. So per kg, it will be 3,750. So that is the rate about 3 years before I have seen from internet. Okay. So this is a saped musli. Don't you think, is it the only saped musli? There are many species in our Western Ghat in peninsular India. 22 species are there. And each one must be having the active components. And that is one important source which we can use. Now, another source is our Dremia. And in Dremia, see, I have, because for students' sake, for last 2 days, I was sitting and giving the names to the plants so that students will not make mistakes in identification. Lot of, you know, halla-balla has been made during past with the identification of plants. There are many wrong identifications. But these are, you can take it, almost 99%, whatever I have written is correct. So you can refer my PDF file and you can identify. Dremia indica, Dremia govindappi, Dremia raujaviki, Dremia raji, Dremia polyantha. Okay. So Dremia nagarjuni. So these are the species in our country, right? You can see this Dremia whitey, Dremia raujibiki, right? Then you see these populations in South India in sandy soil and they have bulbs. And this is one very promising species, Dremia nagarjuni, which has very large bulbs. You know, see this nagarjuni. It is like an agave plant. And you know, I just to understand this species and to know it, I spent about 20 years to in search of this plant, nobody was knowing. Finally, we could locate it in our Kerala region. What is that sanctuary? I don't remember all of a sudden. And this is that Raujibiki. Now, what is important about for this genus is Drimia indica. Drimia species contain bupadenoids, cardiotonic glycosides, which are very important. Similarly, on various diseases, it is used. This is another. And, you know, Drimia raji, Nagarjuni, Rao Jipiki, then your Polyantha, all of them are endemic and rare plants of our country. And that way, you should look at this genus about this. Then another genus is a Dipkadi. There are about 10 species in Dipkadi in our country. Dipkadi concanens, Dipkadi govens, Dipkadi madrasicum, Dipkadi minor, Dipkadi montana, Dipkadi saxorum, Dipkadi ursuli, and Dipkadi erythrea. So these are the species in our country. Why I am showing this slide to you? In Rajasthan, whenever there is a famine or there is a food shortage, people dig these bulbs and they eat. So this is a plant which has a edible bulbs. Similarly, in our region, this Dipkadi minor, they have needle-like narrow leaves, and they collect when these plants sprout after rains, collect the leaves and make vegetable out of it. It has a lot of fats and it is very nutritious, and that is known as suichi bhaji or needle vegetable. Similarly, Dipkadi concanens, there also they collect leaves and make leaves. So entire all the plants of this genus are edible, and that way it has a great significance in future. That's why I have shown all the Dipkadis of our country and their economic potential and how we can utilize it. Now I come to palms. Okay. Now, palm has a great ornamental value. All of you will agree with me. Great ornamental value. This is Bentikia codopana. Okay, Bentikia codopana, which grows in inaccessible places in Kerala at higher altitudes. And, you know, getting seed also goes very difficult. Now, we have started a program bringing all the palms in botanical gardens. And now, we have brought this Bentinckia codopana, Bentinckia nicobarica, and then Pinyanga mani. Many of them we have brought in botanical gardens, and they are of great ornamental value. Okay, now you see this palm I am talking to you. It is from peninsular India, Corypha umbraculifera. If you go to Yana, entire Yana forest, you know, on one side you will see this palm forest. You know, these are the palms. You tell me whether we have utilized this resource anytime in our country. No, we have not used it. And you see, it is a unique. When it flowers, it produces largest panicle in the world with largest number of seeds, and it is a elegant look, and after that it dies. Such a palm we never brought to the gardens. We never utilized it for other purposes. We feel, yeah, it is growing there. We don't respect our own plants. See this beautiful palm. And this palm, I should tell you why I'm telling you, because I have done it. We have now many plants in our lead botanical garden, and we have given to many people by collecting seeds. It is easy. How we can sustain? We have to propagate, give it to people, request them to plant, and that way we can increase the population of these plants. Okay. Now see this another palm. I want to tell you, this is a rare palm. It is known as Hypini dichotoma. In South also some places we get, and West Coast it is a common. Not common. It is endemic to India. It is Hypini dichotoma. You see this, how it looks, Hypini dichotoma. Why not to, you know, grow as an ornamental plant? Is it not ornamental, dichotomously branched? So this is one source we can utilize. About palms, I have said enough. About monocots, now let us go to dicots. And you know, Garcinia, this is one source, and you know, many species, almost all the species, are endemic to peninsular India. Okay. And each Garcinia species is the one very important resource. This is Garcinia xanthochymus. This is Garcinia indica. Okay. This is Garcinia talboti. This is Garcinia gummigatta. And this is, you see, gummigatta and this is indica. Then see this all. This has been done by our Mohanan. And you see this, all the species of Garcinia and their fruits. Now, this is source of our country. Bioresource of our country and the entire world is after these bioresources. And you see how many products are there? No, Garcinia, Himalaya, Garcinia, then Garcinia, Cambogia extract, and you see forever Garcinia plus. See this. These are the Garcinia, Cambogia, Garcinia. Now, the importance has come to surface, but at the same time, you know, their sustainable utilization is very important. How we are going towards sustainability, or we are going to exploit all the wider resources and make them, sparse, this is not the way we should go. So these are the resources. So this is about Garcinia, which we have, you know, Garcinia, Cambogia, Ayur Slim, Garcinia, Cambogia. These are the drugs you can see, 60 units, whatever tablets are there, and this is their cost. What I want to tell you, these are rare plants. They are only found in Western Ghats, nowhere else. And if we don't use them sustainably, their depletion is bound to happen in nature. Okay, so Garcinias, all that I told you story. Now I come to the another member of Clujiaceae, that is our Nagakesha. This is our Missua perua. And you know, these stamens are used in spices, these stamens. For that it is exploited. And we need to, this is also endemic. This need to be propagated and grown in gardens. Whatever I am showing, all those plants I have brought to the garden and I distribute to the people. Okay. Now see, this is Xanthoxylum rhodesia. This is in the Indian list, it is one of the 10 topmost plants for propagation. Because, you know, from nature every year, people collect fruits in tons. You see, in tons they collect, seeds also they bring, and that way there is no natural seeding in nature. And this is a very important source. Used in pains, diseases of heart, mouth. It is also a very good spice. So this is one member which I wanted to tell you, our bioresource, right? And this Xanthoxylum rhodesia, if you want to listen, peel up the fruit, seeds, bark of the stem and roots, as well as oil extracted from fruits, are used in medicinal purposes. All these are uses. I will not go. I am just showing you resources which we have and how we should go judiciously. Now, Imbelia ripes. When you go ask in market, wouding seeds, which are used in medicines, real wouding we don't get. In Maharashtra, in total northern western Ghats, so far, I could locate only three or four plants. Only when we go down to Castle Rock, we get this plant in Ghat areas. It is also a very rare source, rare plant becoming rare. People are collecting seeds and in market, Missa indica fruits are sold instead of Imbelia ripes, and that sometimes they don't work. So this is another plant. Okay. So Neeraj traders, this is wouding seeds, price 100 grams, 149. So 1,490 rupees per kg. This is the market price. And this plant, I have not seen anywhere in any botanical garden, in any agriculture department, propagation of this plant and developing, cultivating this plant for wouding. I have not seen. this needs to be done. Saraka Ashoka, all of you know, its a bark is used in many Ayurvedic preparations, and this is really speaking a rare plant. In Western Ghat, only in very evergreen patches you get few trees here and there. And we need this tree in a large quantities for bark. Fortunately, awareness has been created, and in Maharashtra, many institutes have raised many seedlings and they have taken program of plantation. So this is one Saraka Ashoka. Equally, it is a wonderful plant. You see this beauty, and really Sita Mai was lucky that she was kept in such a wonderful forest of Saraka Ashoka. Hey, Sitecha Ashok. This is another endemic plant. This is our Lichia tomentosa, and this Lichia tomentosa is used in bone fracture, rheumatism, burning sensation, bronchitis, fever, and paralysis. Many of you may not have seen this plant. So this is a plant of great, and we need further phytochemical analysis, bioprospecting of these things. In recent years, all the species of Salicia have come to prominence. I was not knowing its importance. But when I read and many people started talking and they started asking material for their chemical analysis, I realized that it is an important plant. So Salicia possesses anti-diabetic, anti-diuretic, laxative, anti-obesity, cardioprotective properties. So these are the compounds. They have these properties, and these are our species, Salicia macrocarpa, Salicia chinensis. In addition to this, I should tell you, Salicia chinensis is a very, very good hedge plant. It grows in extremely dry conditions, and we need not to bother for its survival. On its own, it grows throughout year. It is evergreen. I found it is one of the best wild plants suited for botanical gardens for various purposes. Okay. Plus, it produces red berries, and birds are attracted. So this is another bioresource. Then this is a Capparis moni, and fruits, you know, large fruits about 5 to 10 centimeters in diameter. These are collected from wild and sold in Bombay market. I don't know where they go, but this is the thing. And day by day, this endemic species is becoming rare. Paste of root bark applied to boils and swellings of testicles. Decoction of bark is given in syphilis. Fruit is used in cardiac troubles. So these are the uses which I got from some book. I am not a doctor. Now see, this is another very interesting story for you. Sandh Kuda. This is known as Antiaris toxicaria. You know, toxicaria, toxic plant. This is a melinfloral, this is a seed, and you see this is a huge tree. In Yellapur region, we get these trees. In Maharashtra, only in Devrais, we get this tree. And this tree is common in Java. And Java's king killed 13 wives with the latex of this plant. He put latex on the apex of arrows, and then he shoot those wives, and all the 13 wives died in 10 minutes in great agony. So this is a history of this plant. And this plant I was searching in Maharashtra, one day we located, and you know, its seeds are diabetic. So far no work has been done. Though I have given lectures at many places, but nobody has done careful studies on seeds. And it was done in Delhi also, and it works as a anti-diabetic, they are anti-diabetic. So this is one plant. I can tell you long story, but I am curtailing because of time. Now this is our Mauloa spicata. You know, when all the medicines fail, Vaidya says Mauloa spicata or Vakirisa Bhata, it will work. Its roots, root cap is used in medicine. So this is also endemic species to our Western Ghat. Then another plant group, Holy Garna, Grama, these are Anacardiaceae members, and they have very poisonous latex in our biba, anacardium occidental. Then holigarna, gramae, holigarna, arnoldiana. Then this is a nothopegia, colubrochiana. All of them have latex, which is very poisonous. And all of us, we know, anything which is very poisonous in small quantities, it acts as a medicine. So these plants, our research scholars should analyze, our phytochemists should analyze and find out if there are some bioactive molecules. So these are plants. Say, for example, this is our Holigarna arnoldiana. These are the photographs from my own garden. I planted about 5-6 years ago. This year they have fruited, so I have taken photograph. It is anti-cancer, anti-inflammatory, hypotensive. It cures arthritis, cancer, inflammation, obesity, piles, tumors. These are the uses given. Is it not an important bioresource? We have never used this bioresource. And it is easy to grow also. So this is one. Then this is another Holigarna arnoldiana, similar closely related species, right? Then this is Nothopegia colubrochiana, anacardium member. In our area, latex is put on joint and it relieves the pain, joint pain. And this way, this is another plant. Fruits are edible. Okay, I have not talked about wild fruits which are edible. These are also bioresources. And they can help us in sustainable development. Now, Hydnocarpus, Pentandra. Again, it is endemic to Western Ghat, comparatively rare plant. Hydnocarpus pentandra is the major source of chalmogra oil. Okay? This is a major source of chalmogra oil, which is used in medicine. Another Miliaceae member, that is Dicyozylum binectariferum. Of course, it is found in Ceylon also, but it is only in Maharashtra, only in sacred groves or very thick forest we get these plants. So these are, our hornbills live on them. And this Dicyozylum binectariferum bark was identified as an alternative source of CPT. CPT means our camptothecin. Now camptothecin, we have already explored Mapia, Fotida, or Mapia pneumoniana now. And this bark, they contain camptothecin. It is anti-cancerous. And many drugs have come from this plant. 22 alkaloids have been extracted so far, but I have knowledge. Now, this is Dicyozylum malvaricum, which is endemic to Western Ghat and is a locally economically important tree species endemic to the Western Ghat. It is a sacred tree that is harvested from the wild and used for medicinal, nutritional, commercial and religious purposes. Now this species, have you seen anywhere in any nursery? We raise the saplings, we raise the seedlings, we collect the seeds. We don't do, I know. I move in all the peninsular India. I have not seen people doing these efforts. So we only exploit wild resources, which how to be protected. Okay, and this is another plant. Our Sauropus androgynous lives with high antioxidant potential, lives used to treat certain diseases, lives contain adequate amount of macronutrients. Okay, so it is something like a health tonic, and it is also known as the insulin plant. I don't know. So a lot of flavonoids are reported from the leaves. So this is one plant which is bioresource. Now just I want to give you idea about some plant, Leptadenia reticulata. Now this is a plant which grows in extremely dry region, and Leptadenia reticulata is an Ayurvedic herb used for treatment of fewer urinary infections, improving the eye vision and for nourishing. It is known as Nanisia, natural Jivanti. Now, when I saw what is a market value, 1 kg of roots of this plant is 5,950. This I have seen two years before. Now, this plant, is it not a very important bioresource? And then, if we go on exploiting this plant along with the roots, populations will go down. So again, sustainable use of this, propagation of this is very essential in coming years. Okay, this story, Jivanti, all of you know what is Jivanti's story, Trichopus gelanicus, I will not go because all over South India about this plant, it is well known. Okay, this is a traditional knowledge and by of Kani tribal, and this is one of the very important plant, Jivani. Its a name is Jivani. Okay, so anyway, now one more plant I want to talk is about this one, Morinda citricifolia. Okay, it grows in the entire peninsular India in sandy soils. And you know, I have seen 60, it is said that it works on almost 60 diseases, human diseases. Is it not a very important bioresource? So Polynesian healers have used noni foods for thousands of years to help treat a variety of health problems such as diabetes, high blood pressure, akins, and so on. And now that noni product is also, you see noni. I know in Shivaji University, somebody used to come to sell this noni bottle. One bottle, he will ask me to pay 2,000 rupees. I never understood why it is so costly. It is extract of about 2 to 3 fruits. People are making money, but exploiting natural resources. So what's about sustainability? Okay, so this is a prize noni. Then mucuna, mucuna prurens, and then we described one species, mucuna sanjipi. This is mucuna sanjipa. Prurens has 3% L-DOPA, while the new species which we have described is having 7% L-DOPA in seeds. So this is a new discovery by my lab. And you know, see this Kauchi beach powder, 250 grams, cost you 365. That is our normal prurens. But if we use the sanjipi seeds, it will have double the price. And that plant is rare in Maharashtra, only in Junnar region, which needs to be propagated. Very rare. Okay. Now, I come to some, you know, succulents in Bombay or in Delhi or in many places. When there is a question of succulents, people pay any amount to buy succulents. Now, this is one species, Euphorbia gokakensis, which grows as a bush. Okay, this is a bush, and you can see this, it is a very important succulent. People are after succulent. They want to collect succulent from all over the world and they want to grow. In our country, we don't never care for our own succulent. This is one species. Then Rowlphia serpentina, already it has become very rare plant in wild. It was exploited extensively probably in past. And that has given us, you know, you see this Rowlphia serpentina, this is another plant. We did not exploit it in a proper way or sustainably, and plant has become rare and there is need to cultivate it. So the plant contains 200 alkaloids. Rowlphia serpentina contains 200 alkaloids, and these alkaloids are very important for blood pressure, high blood pressures. They work very mental disorders and so on. So this is one plant. See this, I think I have said. Now you see, this is the wilder relatives of cultivated plants. If we want to increase yield of our plant, this is resistance of our plant. There are many wilder relatives. Just I want to touch that point, that while the relatives of cultivated plants are common in Western Ghats, and you know, this is a Vigna condolensis, which grows about 2 meters in height and stem diameter is about 1 inch. It is the most robust species of Vigna in our country, and it is endemic to Northern Western Ghats. So it is a bioresource in hybridization program, improve of Moog, this plant is going to help, and that way also our bioresource is important. See our vignas, all these vignas which are there, about 30 vignas, 26 species of vignas, all these are our bioresources. Then this is another our Taberni montana, alternifolia, which is a source of camptothecin. Then this Phytosporum. This is another genus I don't know much about. We have only one species in Maharashtra, Phytosporum desiccolon. And you know, it has many uses. You can see this bark possesses narcotic properties. It is used as a febrifuge in chronic bronchitis and so on. So this is another, and they are endemic. Desiccolon is endemic, rare plant in Western Ghats. Then this is our Fakursia montana. See the fruits, which are, you know, now many educated people, people in urbans, they are after anti, what we call this is antioxidant. They call it as antioxidants. Mineral-rich fruits. These are the mineral-rich fruits, and this is endemic. This is our bioresource. Then similarly, this is our Mamia suriga. These flowers are used in spices. Okay, and see this plant, which is slow-growing and endemic to our Western Ghats. Then you see this Harpulia. Okay, Harpulia. This Harpulia, I have planted in garden. Now it has started flowering. Don't you think it is a beautifully ornamental plant? Have you seen any time in any botanical garden or any roadside? Only in Western Ghat we have this Harpulia. And when I have grown in garden, now it is flowering, fruiting. And you can see it's a beautiful thing. Everybody will enjoy. Is it not our bioresource for ornamental purpose, if not any medicinal? Then this is Sertia densiflora, which grows in a northern Western Ghat. It is used as a substitute for Sertia chiraica. Lot of plants are collected every day. And how we are going to sustain their populations, I don't know. There is no ban on it for collection. And they are collected from wild. Then similarly, our this one, what is this name? Ancystrocladus henian. See this. It has also very important compounds, and it is used in AIDS. Then this is another critical endangered plant species, Consinium finistratum. You see this Consinium finistratum. It has very high content of berberidine, and it has so many uses. This is also rare. How to use them sustainable? How to increase? Then Artocarpus gomigianus, you know, this is an important bioresource of our many products come from this. Artocarpus hirsutus is a very important as a source of food for wild animals as well as for us and as a timber. Then this is a Narkia. Okay, its story I will not tell you, but now it has become a rare plant. We have never utilized it sustainably. Lot of smuggling was done of this plant, and now it has become comparatively rare in Western Ghats. So this is a story. Cucumis. Now Cucumis setosus is endemic to Western Ghats. Cucumella and all these are edible. Now cucurbits is another bioresource, and many of the species are endemic to Western Ghat. We have to take care and use. Okay. See this cucurbits, another group of great potential. Then this is the Bumantia. See this largest flower in our Apocynaceae. Such a, can we grow as an ornamental in our garden? This is one. Barlerias. This story I always tell. There are about 30 species of Barleria in India, and we have grown 22 species, about 20 to 22 species in botanical garden. See the colors of flower, see the growth habit, and so it is one of the very important bioresource as a ornamentals, as a medicinal plants, as a landscaping gardening, and that way as a hedge plants, as a age plants, and whatnot. see this begonia of Western Ghats. Names I have not given because of lack of time. All these begonias have beautiful flowers. We purchase begonias, foreign begonias from Africa for 300, 400, 500 rupees per plant. Here we have begonias. We never domesticated it and made them as ornamental horticultural plants. Though we have many institutes, government institute working on, but they never thought of begonia. They thought of gladiolus, they thought of bougainvilleas, they thought of plants from other countries, but our own plants never got importance. Okay, see this one plant we described, Corynandra elegans, which has one of the beautiful flowers of the world. There is need for domestication, and this will be very good ornamental plant. Somebody has to work on it. See this Cirripedias. All the Cirripedias I have labeled here for you. I spent about 3 hours to label them. So now I am giving you 37 Cirripedia photographs, flower, so that student can identify. See this Cirripedia. Are they not of great ornamental value? They have tubers which are edible. They have leaves like Cirripedia bulbosa, leaves we can eat. So these Cirripedias are our bioresources as ornamental plants, as a tuber starch yielding plants, edible plants, but who will work on their domestication? Okay, so these are Cirripedias of your country. And then I have done little efforts. This is a Delphinium malbaricum, which we domesticated, tried to domesticate and released a package of practices for cultivation of this. Of course, farmers have not come forward to grow them, but this is one plant I have tried. And if we really do it, 1 acre will fetch about 2 lakh rupees. So this is the one which I have done. Now see this impatience. So many impatience in Western Ghats, none of them is in cultivation as ornamental. Why? What are the problems with impatience of Western Ghat? So those who are scientists, those who are research scholars, they should think and bring some of these species in a garden, domesticate them, spend your whole life for domestication of barlerias. Impatiens. So these are beautiful impatiens which have a great ornamental value. So I discussed plants of ornamental value, wild relatives of cultivated plants, then wild fruits I have not said, but they have a lot of minerals. They are iron rich. Those we have now, those are resources. Then our medicinal plants, then our roadside trees, all that we have with us. But there is a need for collaboration, and that way only we can really these rare plants we can conserve, we can utilize sustainably, and we can progress. With these words, once again, I thank organizer for giving me opportunity to share what I feel about our plants and what is our Western Ghats to us. It is very dear, very near to my heart and every one of us in Peninsular India, because it is one of the richest center of flowers, animals, and whatnot. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for that visual taxonomical treat we had on the Saturday. We are actually speechless because you have given so well identified photographs of so many species. Especially the students and researchers here are going to learn a lot. Those 37 Cirripedias that you have shared, the cucurbits that you have shared, I think it's really going to be useful for the researchers. And I'm sure, sir, as you have suggested, many students and researchers would take lead from here and further take up their studies to make use of this important species as a important bioresource. And also when they go into the field, they will think of collecting seeds, think of sowing them, and then contribute towards the conservation. With these few words, I would like to hand over to Manasvi to take over the questions from the participants.
Thank you, ma'am. So one of the first questions we had was from Dr. Savita Murthy. She asks you, where exactly do you find cranium malbaricum in Western Ghats?
Cranium malbaricum, we have described, you know, it peria in our, what is that area? Peria means almost near Mangalore, there is a region known as Peria. And in that Peria village, I don't remember, there is a village near to highway. There you have to go inside and there we get in Peria.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another person asks how to start their ethnobotany career.
Ethnobotany career, see, it is your passion. Passion works a lot. And if you are a young man, if right from now, if you start collecting information about plants, how tribal people use them, what are the, ways, exactly documenting the way this, plants are used by people, and really you confirm them many times, and if you keep on working for 10 to 20 minutes, you will be one of the best ethnobotanist of this country. It is a passion. We don't need much money, much equipments, just documenting our biodiversity. And you know, there is now at a central government level, they have one, what is that, TD, something like that. Traditional knowledge, they are documenting and digitizing. And all our knowledge, because we have to establish our rights on this. And when you document this knowledge about plants, please, the person who has given you information, his knowledge has to be, given respect, and that has to be mentioned in that, along with address, along with his credit. Okay? So this is what we need to do in future.
Ria asks, what is the scope of medicinal botany in India?
See, at least in COVID time, we should not, in COVID time, if you remember, I told just in the beginning, I was talking with Dr. Haridasan, medical botany, you know, whatever allopathy is there, still 80% of our population depends on plant medicines. 80-90% of plants come from, medicines come from plants, at least in the beginning. And therefore, medical botany has a great significance, only it has to be done systematically. Okay. Here, very important hint I want to give you. Scientific validation for any medicinal use need to be done. Then only people will believe in us. Others will believe in us. Only in our country, in Ayurveda, we don't have methodology to validate scientifically any medicinal value which we have to do it, right?
Thank you, sir. We have Aditya from YouTube asking us, he wants to know more about Hemidesmus indicus plant.
Hemidesmus indicus, whatever little I know, Hemidesmus indicus is an Anant Mool. And one thing, you know, one doctor came with the Hemidesmus indicus root, which was about 1 inch in diameter. Then I asked him, this is not by Hemidesmus indicus. And then we came to know that Anant, you know, gardenia, which we grow in garden, we call it as Anant, and its root is given in market. So it does not work. And Hemidesmus indicus root is a very, very good, it has a lot of good properties. If blood urea goes up, and if you just crush these roots in water, little roots, and take it, next day your blood urea goes down. So blood poisoning can be reduced with this Hemidesmus indicus. And this is our own experience with Ayurvedic doctors. Not that I have done, our Ayurvedic doctors have done, because I showed them correct source of medicine, that is Hemidesmus indicus. This much I know about hemidesmos. And there are a lot of variations, morphological variations in hemidesmos indicus throughout India.
Okay. Prashant very eagerly asked, what is the procedure for publication of a new species?
See, these things, new species, I can give you one lecture because it needs little more time precisely how to describe species. Okay. Now, most of the young workers want to describe new species. Of course, it is a great credit in life. Everybody should describe. But one thing, many species described by in recent years may not stand. Okay, may not stand. Little difference. They want to make a species. You tell me, in human beings, we have Negroes, we have Indians, we have Japanese, we have Chinese, we have Europeans. All have different characters, very fixed character. Why we don't keep them in a one species? Why we keep them in a one species? Why we don't recognize species? That they, this concept they don't apply. Anyway, if you have got something which is unique, first thing you have to go through literature, find out. Now it is easy. You know, you can see, compare your specimen to which species it is closely allied. Then see their type, see their protolog, and then compare if there are distinct differences. And if your species is represented by good population, not one or two plants, good population, then you write a paper in which, you know, you have to give abstract and then you have to give little what way, to which species it is related and what are the differences, then description, etymology, and all that. If you see any paper, you will come to know. But before that, you should be very confident about whether really it exists, it is a different from rest of the species in the world belonging to that genus.
Thank you, sir. We might actually take you up on the offer of having another webinar only on new species and publication. another question is, what are some critically threatened species of Western Ghats that need tissue culture attention?
Number one, I have shown you your Crinum brachinema. Only may not be 1,000 bulbs throw so far, even less than that must be existing in natural habitat. Less than 1,000 bulbs of single species located to single hill, number one. Number two, Crinum malbaricum, which is only restricted to 0.5 square kilometers in the entire world. Then there are many Cirripedias. Okay, I have given you Cirripedias. Many of them are critically endangered. At least whatever photographs I have provided, at least 10 to 15 species are critically endangered. So there is a long list of critically endangered, endangered and threatened species. But for peninsular India, you know, I would say, I have to make a list and really give it to you. Especially, you know, there are some legume trees. Dr. Sanjapa, I am talking, and they are represented by one or two individuals. That is what they are telling. Don't you think they are most critically endangered species? There are some trees. There are only few trees. And you know, in all the trees are in Kerala, endemic trees. And we don't have access to germplasm, seeds, so that we can propagate in botanical gardens and distribute to people. There is a forest department, there is the NBA, there is so many permissions, and who has that much patience to do it? Unfortunately, that's why I said, in this country, those who want to do good for the country, they are sufferers. They are not able to do it. Okay. Probably this will be listened by some people. At least they will understand what is the problem of our scientists or botanists today, because they don't have access to germplasm. Of course, permissions are needed, but you know, educational institutes, which are country's most important organizations, why there should be so much restrictions to them? And you know, going and begging and you know, forest department, bureaucracy prevails everywhere, and academicians, well, okay, will not tolerate these things. So they don't go through them.
Riya Ghosh from YouTube is asking, Cranium albaricum, is it an invasive species, sir?
Oh, what? Who is asking this?
Riya Ghosh is an aquatic plant ecologist.
Yeah. Riya, it is recently described a species. It is not an invasive. It is only restricted to one stream, and then again it is recorded from another stream, and it is not recorded anywhere in the world. If it is invasive, it should have occur in other countries. Then it will come here, but it is not so. It is our own endemic species.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I think we'll take one last question. Somebody very fascinatingly asked, how many flowers or plants have you come across? I just like that question. How? There must be so many, right? Yeah.
Now, how many flowering plants I have come across?
Yes.
I'm estimating I must have seen about 10,000 flowering plants in my life. Okay, wow. 10,000 plants seen by my own eyes, okay, in my this life. About wow. 10,000.
That's wonderful. Even your photographs are such a testament to that. Yeah. I'll take one last question, actually. Kanjanjam is asking, how are plants correlated with biotechnology and environmental management and sustainability?
See, this is a question. Really, biotechnology is a branch which can help us a lot. Okay, biotechnology, in various ways, multiple ways, biotechnology has a lot of role to play in coming years. Number one, when we want to suppose some species which are endangered, but they don't produce seeds, there is some barrier in reproduction, then best way go for mass propagation and where our biotechnology can help us. Second, you know, bioprospecting of our plants, suppose phytochemical analysis, which will lead to discovery of new bioactive molecules, and then drug discovery, there also biotechnology will be playing important role. You know, our plant products, you know, say for example, our wild fruits are there. Now that, you know, our karwand barfi has come. So here biotechnologists, food technologists have worked together. They have done in a such a way that waste going plants, fruits, which in nature, they have made products, useful products, and they are sold like anything in urban cities, okay? Urban situations. So this way, various way biotechnology can help in bioprospecting, sustainable use, and it can reduce wastage of many of our plants, fruits, or leaves, or whatever. So that way, biotechnology as a great role to play.
Thank you, sir. Everybody is very eager to have to
sir,
have
one question.
Activities. Yes.
Sir, one question.
Yes, this go ahead.
Some cylindrical tuberous fruit sold in the market, taking slices in the name of Bucha Karagata. We generally botanists call it as Mero Aplangifolia. Is it Mero Aplangifolia or some other, sir?
See, sir, this is I think Sanjay also asked me this question. In our area, it is sold as a Ramakand. You know, this is a tuber, no? Ramakand. Ramakand. Are you getting me? Ramakand.
Yes, sir.
Ramakand. In our, especially in the Ganesha festival, these people come and then they sell. See, last, I was searching for its a botanical name for 10 years. I asked our Professor Mohan Ram, Professor Babu, Sanjapa sir, so many people I asked, what is this plant? Nobody was sure about what is its identity. Except V.N. Naik told me, Dr. V.N. Naik is no more, but he said it is an agave species.
Yes, sir. I wrote a small article also on that, sir, in 1994 itself. But people told that it is Merva Oblongi Folia. That is why I'm asking.
Merva Oblongi Folia, sir, it doesn't have that tuber. And Sanjapa has told me I will be going and digging also, but it is a, you know, it will not have such a huge tuber.
Yes, sir.
I am sure.
I also asked a couple of Hemadri, sir. Hemadri also. He doesn't tell anything.
And
but
then,
I too, sir, got the title. Yeah, I gave Americana, I gave Sicilena, I gave Americana.
In current science, that paper has been published.
Yes, sir.
It is done with molecular tools.
Nice.
Right? So, beyond now, it is a Agave Cicalina or Agave species.
Agave Americana. Yes, sir. So, people take slices and apply saccharin for it, and they're sold to the school children, sir. That may have some alkaloids and latex like
no,
that.
No, sir, it is a poison. It is a poison.
Sir,
that's why I have written in papers also, here, newspapers, local newspapers.
I have rather put an adding harmful tuber for children.
Right.
It is harmful tuber, like that.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Thank you for your question, sir. We will now be ending the session. Everybody receive their certificates if they fill the feedback form, and we will also email Yadav sir's PPT to all the participants. Yeah.
Madam, have one question.
Okay, I think we can do this one more question.
The last question.
Yeah. Yes. Last. Yeah.
Sir, myself Karpaswamy from Gandhigram Rural University, Dindigul, Tamil Nadu.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes, how are you, sir?
I am fine, sir.
Sir, I have one question, sir. The herbal formulation and trading systems are growing, even though we are very, the identification of particular plant is very much very necessary, sir. But nowadays, lack of taxonomies, the taxonomists are right persons. We are lacking that knowledge, sir. How can we overcome those problems, sir?
See, this is a question which you are asking, same question I am asking myself for last 35 years. When I did my MSc and PhD, I joined Shivaji University and decided this country needs taxonomists to identify their own plants. People started sending plant like lantana camera to Kew for identification. This is the truth, you know. Then I decided in last 35 years, I tried to train students in taxonomy so that they can identify plants out around us. Unfortunately, we botanists, be botanists, okay? All of us, we are botanists. They feel that it is a role of taxonomists. I feel that it is a role of every botanist and all local plants around colleges in his city, every botanist must know. Unfortunately, they feel that this is my physiology, this is my anatomy, this is my embryology. But botany's primary duty is to know what is this plant, where it grows, for what it is used. And that is one thing. Another thing, taxonomy. You know, for taxonomy, people, if they do biotechnology, if they molecular system, molecular biology, they do biochemistry, they get better job. For taxonomists, somehow it is a thankless job. You know, once you come to know the name, you don't bother. And therefore, taxonomists don't have job potential. Similarly, taxonomists' contributions are not recognized by general public. And therefore, students do not go for taxonomy. Only those who are not able to get in good branches, they come to taxonomy and then those people cannot make difference in this subject. Anyway, so these are things which can be discussed long time, but you know, unless there is a honey in the flower, no honeybee will visit the flower. In field of taxonomy, there is no job potential, sufficient job potential. So students don't go because they are worried for their bread and butter. Today, we give education only for bread and butter, earning bread and butter, not for knowledge. And this is a tragedy of recent system of education.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I think it's rightly said, sir, that we have to look identification at a very critical point. And it's so important for a youngsters today, irrespective of which field it is, they have to understand that they need to have the skill sets of identifying the plants. So you have taken so much of effort in making this PPT. From bottom of our heart, from TDU and all the participants over here, we thank you. And I'm sure this is going to be a very useful lecture for the students and researchers. And I hope they are going to take the lessons from the talk and actually implement it. Thank you so much for one and all.
And that is the purpose of my lecture.
Absolutely.
Even one student.
Yes.
One student follows me.
Yes.
I will be most happy man.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Kindly fill the feedback form for the certificate.
Manasvi, you're supposed to take a group photo?
Yes, yeah. yeah, everybody do switch on your cameras. We'll just take a group photo that will be on our social media.
When you're ready, so that all of us can give you a smile.
Yeah, people are still switching on the cameras, I'm saying.
Okay.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, smile. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Yadav sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Okay, convey my regards to.
Thanks.